Well, praise the Lord. It's good to see everyone this morning, and hope everybody's had a very blessed week. And so let's just go on and start worshiping the Lord. Good to see everyone. We got some coming in. Hope everybody's had a very blessed week, and we got do want to make one announcement. We had family I know Mr. Louis Combs, he passed away, I think, this morning, so be in prayer for the family. And also this past week, one of my classmates, Edwin Musser, he passed away. They had his funeral. And Edwin, he was always just a wonderful person to be around in school. He's always, he's just one of those good guys. He wasn't like me, always in the middle of trouble. He was always trying to do everything that was right. And I know he's a good Christian. I know his family will miss him. Young age, 62. And so keep that family in prayer as well. And so also remember Tuesdays and Wednesday nights. And this Tuesday night, we'll finish up the 22nd chapter of Revelation. And I'm not certain whether I'll go into the Old Testament and show some of the things that will come out into in Revelation. I may need to do that, praying about it. So I know we'll have something for Wednesday, so I just can't say what's going to be right now. So if you got your Bible, let's do our confession of faith. Those that are here, those that are watching, say it like you mean it like said. This is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
I am what it says I am.
I am what it says I am.
I have what it says I have.
Says I have.
And I can do what it says I can do.
Do what it says I can do.
Today I'll be taught.
Today I'll be taught.
The Word of God.
The Word of God.
I boldly confess.
I boldly confess.
My mind is alert.
My mind is alert.
And my heart is receptive.
My heart is receptive.
I'm about to receive.
About to receive.
The incorruptible.
Incorruptible.
Ever.
Indestructible.
Indestructible. Ever living seed.
Ever living seed.
Of the Word of God.
Word of God.
I'll never be the same.
I'll never be the same.
Never, never, never.
Never, never.
I'll never be saved.
Never be saved.
In Jesus',
in Jesus name.
Name. Amen. Hallelujah. I want you to be going into 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And about the time where I messed up, my mind come across where I went and gave blood the other day. And the lady that does the prayer read, she's a good Christian lady. And we always have a good conversation and everything, she was telling about that when she's in church, she's one of the amen people, you know, amen pastor, amen, you know, and says every once in a while her pastor will say something, and she said, "Now I don't know about that," so she'll start thumbing through, and she said that her pastor told her the other day, said, "I know I've either said something or done something when I don't get an amen from you." And she just laughed. She said, "Because I want to make certain that what I'm hearing is right." And that's why I always recommend everybody, whether you're here, whether you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, is always take notes. That way you've got something to go back over. And if you've got questions, you can either catch me after church or message me or whatever and say, "Pastor, what did you mean by that?" Because it's easy to mistake and say something that isn't quite right. So today's message is, what is your mixture or your ingredients? And basically is, what made you the way you are? And can and is there room for improvement? And the older we get, I know the more I reflect and become more aware how far God has brought me from where I was. And I know that He's still working, still molding us today. So let's just go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we just want to thank you in the precious name of Jesus Christ, Lord, for such a beautiful Lord, that we are able to come together to worship song and in word. And Lord, just to know of your love for us and what you're doing for us and through us and with us and by us, Lord God. And Lord, that you just want to bless us, Lord God. And Lord, as we just become more like you, Lord God, we know that everything we need is right there for us. And Lord, you never leave us nor forsake us, even when our faith is being tried like fire, Lord God. And so, Lord, we just thank for the precious Holy Spirit that is with us this morning. We pray for our hearts to be open, our minds to be clear, to receive, Lord God, and, Lord, to know of your love, your grace, and your mercy, Lord. So have your way with us today. For those that are here, those that are listening and watching, Lord, we thank you and we praise you. In the precious name of Jesus, amen. Now, you know, sometimes people struggle. Their struggles start in childhood. Other struggles start when they become teenagers and who they associate with and everything. And then others, they struggle in life as they become adults and with the things that go on and the things that have occurred. And you know, whether it is right or wrong, everyone has a past, and for some, there can be a lot of scars, a lot of hurt, you know. And it's like James Miley says, hurt people hurt people. And until we learn how to communicate and to work through everything, to be more like Jesus, then we struggle through life sometimes. And so as I had you to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, we're not going to get into the nine spirit or gifts of the Holy Spirit, which is basically from verses 1 through 11. We're going to get into the part where everybody's got a purpose in life, and we're not all going to be able to do the same thing as one another. And just because somebody isn't doing what you're doing or isn't thinking like you're thinking doesn't mean that your way is the right way or there is a better way. What matters is recognizing that each person is gifted by God and for God to do his will. So let's start here in the verse 12 of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit are we all baptized in one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit. For the body is not one member, but many. Hallelujah. You know, Paul's trying to get the church to understand that there is one body, and that is the body of Christ. And, you know, we talk about the church, and how many knows what the church is? That's a simple question, and I hope everybody realizes that this building is not the church. You are the church. We are the body of Christ. And when we understand that, we look around and we can see that one person may have talents that other people don't. When we talk about, well, I go to Mountain Harvest Church, or I go to a Bible Baptist Church, or First Baptist Church, or Cliffview Church of God, or Galax Pentecostal Holiness Church, or any of the other churches, we're talking about going to a place where the body together and to worship together. In other words, we have a name. Identify where you assemble with other believers. Romans chapter 12, verse 4 and 5. I'll just read it for you. You can turn there if you want to. It says, for it as we have many members, and all members have not the same office, so be in Christ, and every one members of one another. Or the football's connected to the ankle bone's connected to the leg bone, et cetera, like it. Well, you see, we are like it. Oh, man, and it's sort of like in Romans 12, if you was to read the next three verses, it would tell you about the motivational gifts, the seven motivational gifts, whether you're administrative, prophecy, whether you're a giver or a server or encourager or a mercy person. And those is why we act. It reflects for the reason that we act the way we do. So when God looks at you and me, He does not think one is more important than the other. And I think that is one of the things that when people come in to the house of God, everyone should be treated the same. Everyone should be looked at as the same. Just because one may have a gift different than the other, we're all children of God. And we're all created something to do. That's why he doesn't look at us as who's more important. In verse 15, if the foot shall say, because I'm not the hand, I'm not of the body, I'm not the eye, I'm not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? My. See, that's why not everyone's going to be a doctor. That's why not everyone's going to be a mechanic. That's why not everyone's going to be a business owner. You know, not everybody's going to be a janitor. Or not everybody's going to be a chef. We're all gifted differently. It's important to be able to have eyes. It's also important to be able to hear. It's important to have hands. You know, we watched over the past few years, there has been more recognition for our military veterans that have been caught up in the casualties of war and have lost their arms or legs. Some have lost part of their face. And yet, though they may have artificial arms or limbs, they are still as important as anybody else. They are no less of a person. Though they may not be able to do what they used to do, they are still important to the Lord Jesus Christ. As I was thinking, and the Lord brought a song back to my memory that was probably in the late 70s or early 80s, is sung by Journey, Don't Stop Believing. And it talked about a young girl living in a lonely world, in a young boy living in a lonely world, and they got on a midnight train going to anywhere. And as I was thinking, God was asking me, how many people start out with dreams of good things, of good jobs, of a good life, and only to find out that it isn't that easy, and that sometimes that people get to the point that they feel helpless and hopeless. They feel unnecessary. They feel unwanted. They go through, they make times, they pick up bad habits and down a path, and a lot of times it is a path of destruction. The thing is that God has a purpose for them, a plan for them. And that's why we have to learn that we can benefit by them. You know, the truth is that when we think how important God is to us, because of
We wouldn't have no hope of eternity. But because of him, we have his word that is forever settled in heaven and in earth. And, you know, sometimes we look at people and say, boy, I wish I could be like them. And if we really do, we probably say, boy, I'm glad I'm not like them. Because God's created us to be who we are. With God, there's no big I's and there's no little U's. You may never be, like I said, owner of a company, but what you're doing, and if you're doing your best, then God will always. You see, it isn't where you have been or what you have went through. It is where God is placing you to use the talents. You know, we often think of, you know, if I could be like them, maybe my life would be different. Sometimes I look around. We were discussing yesterday evening as we was coming back home, and at times our family is dysfunctional. And when I'm saying that, I'm talking to the family on one side. I said the family, the Brewer family, they were just a roughneck bunch. They sort of, you might as well say, they at times they were like a bunch of heathen, like good people. Dad, he was always tried to be straightforward, truthful, and I never seen him do anything wrong, as I remember anything. I guess I made up for a lot of it because I was the wild child, being the only one. I was spoiled. I got to do what I wanted to do, and if I got in trouble, I got bailed out there. Mom would always bail me out of trouble if I got in trouble. And that wasn't necessary. It would have probably been better if I'd learned a few things the harder way, so then I would have made better choices on what I did. I want you to go to the book of Judges, chapter 6. In the book of Judges, and I've related to this story quite often over the years, is that Gideon, he didn't look too highly of himself. How many of y'all know people that have low self-esteem? In other words, they look at themselves and say, you know, I'm just not much. I'm not worth much. Well, in verse 12, now Gideon's working, trying to get their harvest in. And in verse 12, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him, talking about Gideon, and said unto him, the Lord is with thee, thou man. Now I want you to look what Gideon said. And Gideon said unto him, oh my Lord, if the Lord be with us, why then has all this befallen us? For be all the miracles which our fathers told us of, saying, did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt? But now the Lord hath forsaken us and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites. Now, won't you stop? How often have you heard people say, well, if God really cared, I wouldn't be going through this. If God cared, why is all this going on? If God really cared, why is this nation in such a mess? Now you got to remember that Gideon is harvesting their wheat during the night because the enemy is coming to steal their goods. And then in verse 16, the Lord looked upon him and said, go in this might, in thy might, and thou shalt save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have not I sent thee? Now look what Gideon answers. And he said unto him, O my Lord, Wherewith shall I save Israel? Behold, my family is poor in Manasseh, and I'm the least in my father's house. Gideon said, you're saying I'm going to go and save Israel? In other words, I'm a nobody.
Did you read verse 14 too?
Yeah.
Well, you told us 16, so it kind of got us messed up.
Verse 14, the Lord looked upon him and said, go in thy might, and thou shalt save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have not I said thee? And then verse 15, he said unto him, O my Lord, wherewith shall I save Israel? Behold, my family is poor in Manasseh, and I'm the least in my father's house. Again, Gideon looked at himself as being basically useless. And what did God look and see in Gideon? A mighty man of valor. You see, we don't see what God sees. We see what we have experienced, what we are going through, the struggles, the trials, the heartbreaks, the heartaches. We see and feel the memories of the past and the present. Yet God is looking in our tomorrow. God is looking at what He is going to do through us. And that's why it's so important that we not shortchange God. Well, I'll just let somebody else do it. No, if God's instilled it in you. You see, if you have, it's just like God always gives you the first thought. The devil comes and tries to corrupt the second thought. So if God's put in your heart to do something, well, if God is wanting you to do that, the second thought will be, who do you think you are? Do you think you can sing? I can tell you right now, I am not a gifted singer. That's why I don't like to sing by myself. My wife's got a strong voice, and I can sort of just tone mine down, and hers will carry over. She's an alto, and she can sing and do good. We need some sopranos as well as altos, and it wouldn't hurt to have a few of the bass voice. And yet, you know, okay, God, if that's what you want me to do, I'd love to just sit down there or stand in the pews and listen to the praise and worship and just get into the worship. But when I'm up here singing, I'm having to look at the words because I don't have every song memorized. And so it makes it hard for me to get into the Spirit of God. But for those that are gifted and talented, who knows? You know, the hardest part is to focus on what God's wanting to do instead of what we've been through. Paul said, I let go of those things that are behind. Can't change them. He said, I reach for those things that are ahead. Paul understood what it was to go through things. And that's why this is to let you know, those that are here, those that are watching, that God isn't done with you yet. Matter of fact, He's just getting started. And I'll guarantee you, 99.9% of the people have no idea what God will do through them if they'll just open up for Him. Romans chapter 8, verse 20. Know that all things, work together for the good of them that love God and to them who are called according to His purpose. You know, if you love God, He'll take your messed up past and turn it into a blessing for somebody else. It doesn't matter how bad it has been, God will help you to turn it around to help other people so they don't go down that same path. Or if they are, that they won't go as far and they can get back on the path of God. That's why we say, you know, God will take a mess and make a miracle. What may be our heartaches can be somebody else's strength to overcome and move on with God. I thought about, you know, every year there is Christians that commit suicide. A lot of people that aren't Christians do. And that isn't God's plan. God's plan is to position ourselves so that we can be used by Him and for Him and with Him. For in Him we live. Paul said, to live is Christ, to die is gain. And that's often, he was facing death. He was facing prison. And yet he was preaching the Word of God. We'll go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Read a little bit farther. Let's start back over with verse 18. But now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body, as it hath pleased Him. And if they were all one member, where were the body? But now as they many members, yet but one body. You see, God has placed them. That's why I say, you're not here by accident. You're here by God's design. If you're watching, it's not by accident. It's by God's design. And God's design is to bring the body together so that we can do God's work corporately. Each individual. You have your things that you do at work, at home. But then the body as a whole, when it comes together. What is it in the Old Testament? It says if one can put a hundred to flight, two can put 10,000 to flight. You see, God's multiplication is way beyond our way of thinking. And when we come together, I see where they had the men prayer thing up in D.C. And it was packed up there. Some said there's 80,000. Some said there's 100,000. Some said there was more than that. All I know is that what few pictures I've seen is all the way to the Washington Monument, it was packed. And that's great. Why? Because God says when two come together and agree, touching anything, it shall be done of my Father, which is in heaven. There's things that we come to. And that's why He has placed us. Verse, again, let's start with verse 20, read on down to verse 27. But now are they many members, but one body. Now I cannot say unto the hand, I have no need of thee, nor again the head to the feet, no need of thee. Yea, much more those members of the body, which seem to be more feeble, are necessary. Wow. I want you to ponder that thought. Paul said we need the feeble. They're necessary. We need the weak. When people sick, guess what? He gives us something to pray about. He gives us something to do, to reach out and help. And those members of the body, which we think to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundant honor. And our uncomely parts have more abundance. For our comely parts have no need. God hath tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacked, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should be have the same care one of another, for another. And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it, or rejoice in it. Now ye are the body of Christ, and members in particular. You see, that's why it doesn't matter how poor a person is. It doesn't matter if a person's got disabilities. It doesn't matter if you're one of the richest people on planet Earth. Everyone is necessary. Everyone. And that's why God don't want us to think that one is better than the other. But let those that have honor those that haven't. Let's lift them up. Because who knows who our next leader might be. It's not like, you know, we look at, well, it's not like it was back then. Well, yeah, it is in a lot of ways. And I'll lay you odds that there was nobody in Israel would have thought that Gideon would end up being the leader that would destroy over 120,000 fighting men of the enemy, the Midianites. And you know how many men that Gideon had to do it with? At first he started out with 20,000. And God said, you got too many men. That's just 1/6 of what he was going up against. And he said, all right, all y'all that don't want to go to battle, y'all going back home. And a huge chunk of them went back home. And God told Gideon, he said, Gideon, they still too many. He said, take them down to the river and see how they get water to drink. And a lot of them went down there and they put their face in water and they lapped at water. But then there was a few of them that went down there. They knelt down, they cupped up the water, and they took them a drink out of their hand. And God told Gideon, he said, take them with you. You know how many he had? He had 300 men to go up against 120,000. And you know what? God got the Midianites afraid of Gideon. Because Gideon sent out the enemy where they were camped at. And lo and behold, what were they talking about? Man, there's something about that Gideon. I'm really leery of him. I'm scared of him. 120,000 against 300? And they were more afraid of Gideon and his small army? And so God purposed in Gideon. So Gideon told the men, he said, we're going to get around. Y'all get on each side. And when we shout, I want y'all to break these jars, clay pots, and shout about the Lord and Gideon also. And they won that battle with just 300 men. You don't have to be a somebody for God to use you. God and changed Israel just like that. You know, we often think, you know, of people that have different their thinking. It's sort of like the story of Bob. I told many, many years ago. And I'd read it out of a minister's magazine. I guess it's probably been 20 years ago when I read that story about Bob. There was this, at that pastor, he wasn't a pastor. And there's a family that would come to church, and they just wanted to talk. They just loved to talk. They were a poor family and everything, wasn't educated. And this minister, he said, you know, he's one of those that if you see him come in an aisle, you would always make certain you went down a couple aisles to dodge him. And he said, the Lord asked me one morning, he said, do you know everything I know? That minister said, well, Lord, no, I don't know everything you know. Can you do everything that I've done? Well, Lord, no, I can't do everything that you've done. I can't. And God said, and he said, just plain as plain can be. He said, then you're my Bob. And he said after God showed him that Bob was just as important as he was, even though very simple man. You see, sometimes we don't look at things like him. It's like the feeble versus the strong. It's like the poor versus the wealthy. Or the undereducated versus the scholar. Or those that have went to college in America. It shouldn't be black against white or Hispanic against whites or blacks. It should be how can we complement each other to being better at honoring God in everything that we do. There was when we were doing outreach ministry, and before we ever started pastoring here, I was invited to minds went blank on it. A mad church. Mad church, the one goes down the street and starts church. I didn't know that this church that we were invited to come, and Judy and Alita and my cousin, and were invited to sing, and I was going to present the message I did for Sunday morning and Sunday evening. And it just happened that on Sunday evening, a man of God and his wife, and this man was highly educated. He had his doctorate's degree in theology and would talk, or he would teach at Four Square College down at Christiansburg. And I had a high respect for him then. I do now. He's went on to be with the Lord. And when he showed up, when him and his wife showed up, I think, Lord, I can't preach. I mean, you know, I was just thinking. And the Lord spoke to me. He said, you aren't Dr. John. I've not called you to be like him. And then he's been preaching almost as long as you've been alive. So how can you have all the knowledge that he's had? God says, I'm teaching you. I'm learning you. And I have yet to this day preached as hard a message as I preached. I literally lost my voice that night. And I was preaching about the depths of the water in Ezekiel. Farther out we get, the closer, you know, you start out ankle deep, then you get knee deep, then you get waist deep, and then you just get so far out into the presence of God that nothing else matters. God had to remind me. And sometimes we need to remind ourselves. When we see people going through difficult times, the struggles, maybe we haven't. And if we have, can we reach out and help them? I related to when Larry Matthews, I invited him to go with me down to the Life Center one Sunday evening to minister. Larry, he had his doctorate degree from Zoe Bible College down in Orlando, Florida. He had ministered or been taught and ministered under Benny Hinn, OCC Church, Orlando Christian Church, and knowledge. And, of course, the rehab, what's it for? It's for people that's having drug problems and alcohol problems. Well, I can relate to the alcoholism. Been there, done that. And so I get up I just let them know, hey, I've been just like you. And then I turned it over to Brother Larry, and Larry gets up, and Larry just very eloquent speaker and everything, and he said, well, I can't be like Pastor. He said, I've never been like him. He said, from the time I was born, I've always been in church. I've been serving the Lord ever since I can remember. Always been in church. But he said, I can tell you one that'll love you and help you get on the right path. And so he learned, he showed them love and compassion. And that's what we have to do. There is those that never go through what I've been through. Praise God. I hope my grandkids never go through what I've been through. That they stay rooted and grounded and in the house of God, in the Word of God, so that God can bless them day in and day out. And that they'll love everybody. What I've learned is, yeah, there's better ministers out there. There's better truck drivers out there. There's better mechanics out there. I mean, the list goes on and on. I can do certain things, but it doesn't mean I'm the best at it. What I have learned is, I am not in competition with anyone. And that's something that we all need to learn. We should never be in competition with one another, but we should be complementing each one. And if we can complement each one in what we're doing, it will work out. See, I'm to be who God wants me to be. You're to be who God wants you to be. And we come together and we work together, we can make a difference. And that goes for everyone that is here and everyone that is watching. Because if you can be the best you can for God, That's what matters. Because if you'll do what God wants you to do, you can't help but to win. If we'll just serve God in love and compassion and treat everyone with dignity and respect, doesn't mean that we got to agree on everything. Amen? How many knows it's easy to start an all-out war, say Facebook. All you got to do is post an opinion. And if your opinion doesn't line up with somebody else's, you're going to get an earful. Amen? I've been there, done that. Why? Because not everybody thinks like I think. What if everybody was like me? Oh, they'd probably be black eyes. We'd be fighting every once in a while. What if everybody was like you? And some of you, I'd say, praise God. And some would say, oh, no, Lord, please not. Amen. We are each individually and uniquely made in the likeness of God. And nobody can replace who you are. And we're to live for God and do the best that we can do. Hallelujah. I hope that this helps each and every one. Because not everybody's going to think like you. Not everybody's going to act like you. Because you are you. And they are who they are. And I know that I still have room for improvement my own self. Amen. Because I got flaws and I got faults. And God works on me daily. Sometimes I may get to go a few days and God don't have to get on my case. But sometimes he has to say, Randy, you're wearing me out today. Quit letting your mind go down the wrong path. Catch yourself. Don't let that attitude become stinking thinking. Do right. And if we will, we can love everybody. You know, I've been in church. We've had it here. When you got people on one side sitting and people on the other side sitting, and you can feel the tension because they're at each other. Instead of being for each other, they at each other. But praise God, we can get through this. Just like America, we can get through with this diversity that's trying to just turn everything upside down. And our greatest weapon is what is prayer. And we need to come together in prayer. So, now I get to do the great question. How many of y'all got everything right with the Lord Jesus Christ? Those that are here, those that are watching. Because if you don't, right now is a good time to say, Lord, forgive me. And to repent is to turn and go the opposite direction. If you've been going down the wrong road, turn around and go back to the right road. And so let's just pray a simple prayer. And if you'll believe in your heart and confess with your mouth. Father God, I just come to you right now. Lord, if there be any, Lord, right now, that they'll just ask for forgiveness of all their sins. And if they'll ask, I know that you will forgive them. You'll forgive their sins and cast them as far as the east is from the west, never be to remember it again. And Lord, that you just fill them with the Holy Spirit so that from this day on that they can live for you and do your will, do your work, Lord God. And Lord, I also pray that as we're here that we learn to come into unity, Lord God, I thank you for those that are here right now, Lord God, because there is unity, there is peace, there is a willingness to work together and to do your will. And Lord, I just pray for more people that will come and be part, Lord God, of your body, to be used, whether it be the eye, the hand, the foot, the mouth, the ears. Because everyone is important, Lord Jesus. The word that you've given us this morning, let's realize how important each and every one is and should be to us as it is to you, Lord God. And so, Lord, I just pray a blessing be on each one. And, Lord, that you'll use them, give them words that are in season to be a difference maker in this world that we live in today. I pray for peace of America, Lord God, and as well as peace upon Israel. I pray that, Lord God, that our leaders will seek to do your will, Lord God, and your way be done. And so, Lord, just lead us and guide us, and we just praise you in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. I also want to remind you, look on YouTube, Mountain Harvest Pastor Randy Brewer, and also on Facebook, Sunday morning, Tuesdays, and Wednesdays. We love you, and glad you could join us.